Hebrews 12 verse 29, the Bible says, for our God is a consuming fire. That's where we get our name from. We are all nations, restoration, fire church. Fire is the most powerful element of all the five elements that we have. The five elements that are at the root of every phenomena in this world is fire, amen, air, amen, water, the soil we have, right, the earth, and then also time and space. Everybody shall fire, air, water, the earth, and then time and space. These are the five elements. And whoever can master these five elements will be able to move things in this world and cause things to happen. Amen. And God, when he wants to talk about who he is, he says he is a fire. That means that fire is the most powerful element. Light comes out of fire. Is that not so? In fact, the sun, you all know about the sun. It is a ball of fire, isn't it? So when it burns, then it releases that light that we see here. But it's light years away from this earth. But we can all be benefiting from it. Amen. So our God is a consuming fire. Amen. I want us to go to Ezekiel chapter 1. Ezekiel chapter 1. Hallelujah. When you understand this, we want to see the blessings that can come into your life as a result of this manifestation of God. If God is fire, how can that be a blessing to you? Well, if God is fire, then you are also fire. Is that not so? I mean, we are sons and children of God. Like father, like son. Amen. Hallelujah. So as your father is, so you are. Amen. If your father is short, chances are you have to pray hard, you'll be short. If your father is tall, chances are you may be tall. Amen. You take the features of your father. You can't complain about your nose. You have to look at your father's nose. Amen. You take on the features of your father. So if your father is fire, then you are fire. The Bible says in him was light, and the light was the life of men. So our life is light, and light comes out of fire. So we are really fire. See, I am fire. For the Bible says he makes his angels wings and his ministers flames of fire. So even in our ministry and in what we do as pastors, as apostles, evangelists, amen, you do it as fire. If you don't have fire, your ministry is water. Amen. Your ministry has to be fire. Even our prayers have to be hot. The Bible says the earnest, fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much. So the kind of prayers that moves heaven is a fiery kind of prayer. The kinds of prayer that opens the heavens and causes rain to come down is the kind of prayer that will burn you up. Hallelujah. The Old Testament existed in washings and in water. That is why John the Baptist said that I baptize you with water, but the one coming after me, he is mightier than I. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. So that means that the fire is mightier and stronger and more powerful than water.
Yes.
Amen. So fire is critical. And if you are going to have dominion and mastery over this land, this earth, and subdue it, we will have to have the dominion and mastery over fire. And since God is fire, we have to be fire. In fact, Jesus said that one reason why he came to the earth is to baptize the earth with fire. Amen. Luke 12 verse 49. The Bible says that I have come to send fire on the earth. Hallelujah. He didn't come to just do nice stuff and just dance around. He came with an aim. He came with an objective. Hallelujah. And in Luke 12 verse 49, the Bible says, I am come to send fire on the earth. And what will I if it be already kindled? Hallelujah. See, I am the light of the world. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And before he went back to the Father, he said, you are the light of the world. So he says, let your light so shine before men that they will see your good works and give glory to the Father who is in heaven. So your fire must be shining. You are a flame of fire. And what the enemy tries to do is put out your fire. And make sure that you are all dead. When you have no fire, you are dead. That is when you begin to pray the kind of prayers that will just move nothing. Your prayers must move things. Say, my prayer must move things. The prayer that moves things is the fiery kind of prayer. Your God is fire. Even the Holy Ghost, the Bible pictures him as fire. When you go to Revelations, the Bible says that John the Revelator, he saw in front of the Father seven lamps of fire, which are the seven spirits of God, which are sent out into the whole world. So the Holy Ghost is fire. He said, you will receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And a few days later, what happened? They were with one accord in the upper room. And the Bible says, a mighty rushing wind blew. You know that there has to be oxygen for fire, right? And when the wind blew, the fire that was in them was ignited. And the Bible says that a flame was upon each head. Cloven tongues of fire rested upon their heads. And from that moment, Peter was no longer a shy person. The same person who was denying Jesus when a little girl came to him. At this time, he could stand before the Sanhedrin and say, you tell us who we should serve. Amen. In fact, these men, they could preach and pray, and thousands of people could be saved. As Peter was preaching under the fire of the Holy Ghost, 3,000 people gave their lives to God. We need fire in Durham. We need fire in Durham. We are releasing fire in this land. What the enemy tries to do is take out the fire of the churches. Any church that is fiery in the land, the enemy begins to target that church and tries to introduce authenticity into that place. Tries to bring water into that place, water it down. But it will not be so in this church. That is why we have inserted fire into our name. You can't, if you take out all, then we have nations. If you take out nations, we have restoration. If you take out restoration, then you come to what? The fire will burn you. Hallelujah. Shout fire. Shout fire. Shout fire. Hallelujah. God is fire. And when you understand this, the enemy can't put out your fire. You have to put out God's fire before he can put out your fire. Because you are abiding in the fire. Amen. This church, as long as it exists, will be a church of fire. He won. Hallelujah. And this prophet saw God in the Old Testament. He saw him. And of all the prophets that saw God, he is one of the few prophets who actually saw more details about how God looks like. Do you want to see how God looks like? This man saw the heavens open. And he saw a chariot coming from heaven. And the wheels of this chariot were the four living creatures. Amen. And they had a fire within. I mean, they were like balls of fire. The Bible calls them consuming fire. Amen. And the closer the chariot got to him, the more clarity he got. He was able to clearly define the various sections of the vision that he had. And he ended the vision in this particular verse 26. Are we there? Verse 26. The Bible says, and above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne as the appearance of a sapphire stone. And upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness as the appearance of a man above it. So God looks like a man. Women, don't get worried about it. The Bible says in Christ Jesus, there's no male and there's no female. There's no Jew. There's no Gentile. There's no bond. There's no free. We are all one in Christ Jesus. That is why we have all nations. We are all one in Christ Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and I saw as the color of amber, as the appearance of what? Fire round about within it from the appearance of his loins even upward. And from the appearance of his loins even downward, I saw as it were the appearance of fire, and it had brightness round about. So God in essence is fire. Amen. Man in essence is like water and fire and all the elements mixed up. We have the wind, that's our breath. We have the soil, that is our flesh, our body. When it dies, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, right? We have the blood, that is the water, the liquid within us. Amen. We have all the elements within us. And God in essence is what? Fire. When he saw him from his loins, that is from his waist up, was fire. From his waist down is also what? Fire. He's fire. Amen. So God is fiery. So what else can we be but fiery? Hallelujah. If God is fiery, you have to be fiery. Amen. That is why you got very perturbed with the church at Laodicea. They were neither cold nor hot. They were lukewarm. God likes something to be hot. When your prayers are fiery, it attracts him. God likes fire. He likes passion. He likes fervency. Amen. And again, I'll stress this point. What the enemy does is to try to put out the fire and make sure that you are nothing. That is why God, Paul told Timothy, stir into flame the gift of God that is in you. When God starts something, it starts with fire. And over time, the enemy tries to introduce water. You see that? Most of us, when we started our Christian walk, we were on fire. And when if somebody touches you, they burn up. Hallelujah. And then over time, things happen, circumstances, situations, and when you are praying, it's like, Father, we thank you for this day. When will this prayer meeting be over? But there were those days where you say, Pastor, are you? Is it 1 hour past? What is this? Can we pray some more? May God bring your fire back.
Amen.
May God restore the fire to your prayer. May God restore fire to your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. God is fire. The Holy Ghost is also pictured as fire. Jesus Christ, he said, my word is like fire. Amen. And he said, my word is like hammer that breaks rocks. So Jesus is also fire. He can't be light unless he's fire, right? He says, I'm the light of the world. That means he's fire. He said, and I came to release fire on the earth. My purpose is to bring fire on the earth. Say fire. Say, Holy Ghost, baptize me from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet with the fire of God. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Verse 28, Ezekiel 1 verse 28. As the appearance of the bowl that is in a cloud in a day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness round about. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. Shout glory.
Glory.
Yeah. Glory is who God is and all that he has. The glory of God is his essence. That is who he is. The outshinings of his glory, the fringes of his glory, are the miracles, the signs, and the wonders. And Moses realized that the signs and the miracles were not it. He saw that as the house. He said, God, no, please, I thank you that you opened the Red Sea. I want to see you. I want to have experience with that glory. Show me that glory. And whenever the glory of God comes, you see fire there. Fire always comes where the glory of God is. At times, the cloud comes. Amen. And that is powerful enough. But when the fire comes into the cloud, then we know something is going on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So, number one, the fire of God releases the presence of God. Amen. Say, fire of God.
Fire.
Presence of God. So, if a church has no fire, that means the presence of God is not there. But when the fire of God is there, the enemy can't handle it. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's go to Exodus 40. Say fire. Today you shall fire until your mouth becomes fire. Hallelujah. Exodus chapter 40. Oh, Father, we thank you for the fire. The fire of God is in the house. Amen. I'm in Exodus 40. Moses has been instructed to put in place the tabernacle. Amen. He's put all the stuff in there. And he has finished all the work, and he's kind of standing there and surveying the nice work and making sure that, you know, everything is in place, right? The Bible says, verse 33, Exodus 40, verse 33, when he reared up the court round about the tabernacle, and the altar and set up the hanging of the court gate. So Moses finished the work. You want the fire of God in your life? Let there be order in your life. Amen. Well, then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of God filled the tabernacle. Amen. Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Can we all read verse 38? For the cloud of the Lord was upon the tabernacle by day, and fire was upon it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. The Bible says in Numbers 9 that they will not move unless the cloud moves. The fire was direction. When the fire of God is in your life, it brings direction. When there's no fire, you are listless, you are restless, you don't know where you're going. You don't have direction. But fire brings direction. The Bible says that your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So when you're going with the word of God, it's like fire, lighting up your pathways. Hallelujah. So you don't walk in darkness. If you don't have fire in your life, you become rudderless. There's nobody driving you. And you're moving from here, making mistakes, doing trial and error. That will not be our portion. May God bring clarity and direction and guidance into our life. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. May our lamps be burning in the name of the Lord Jesus. So the presence of God is pictured as the cloud and then the fire. Amen. In fact, in Exodus, when Moses was called by God to go up into the mountain, the Bible says that the glory of God rested on the mountain as a consuming fire. And Moses entered that consuming fire. May we enter that consuming fire today. The presence of God, the glory of God is pictured as fire. For our God is a consuming fire. It brings direction. It brings guidance. It clarifies the decisions that we have to make. We need the fire of God in our life. Can I hear a big amen?
Amen.
The fire of God protects you. Say, the fire of God protects me. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 4, verse 5. Amen. May the fire of God protect us. You realize that if you go and to some places and you go and do camping. Who has ever done camping here before? I haven't had that privilege yet. I'm not relishing that even. Hallelujah. Okay, my sister has had that experience. Okay. You guys don't go camping? Really? You're like me. Oh, my sister has had amen. For me, it's tough for me to understand the concept of camping. Somebody will have to educate me on the camping. I like my bed. I don't like mosquitoes and flies. Amen. I don't like any animal around me. Amen. I want to be able to be where I can control my environment. But those who go out, they have fun. You've been on camping before? Yes. I'm not talking about camping where you go inside the building. No. Out in the woods. You went camping. Amen. Sleeping in the bush and everything. Amen. What do they normally do? They must have fire. Right? Some of the dangerous places, if you don't have fire, things will come into your tent. When animals see the fire, they stay away. Amen. In the same thing, spiritually, when the enemy sees fire, he stays away. There's a story of, there was a witch doctor who became a Christian. And he was testifying about some of his experiences. And they said that one of their jobs is to attack Christians. And the ones that they could attack easily were those whose fire was small. They could see in the realm of the spirit how fiery you are. Amen. And they would target those who are not when their fires are so low. Amen. And there was a man of God. They've been taking out men of God and churches and stuff. But there was a man of God. Whenever they go close to him to take him out, something will happen to them. They couldn't touch that man of God. So they went to their boss and said, why can't we deal with this guy? He said, well, as for this guy, he's off bounds to us. And we can't touch him. This is the leader of the Deeper Life ministry. You know the Deeper Life church? Yeah. That was the pastor. They were trying to take him out. Whenever they got to him, fire would come. And then they would just have to just move away. Are you hear what I'm saying? When you are firing, the enemy stays away from you. When the monkey says the house fly cannot stay on a hot pot.
That's right.
So when your pot is cold, all the flies are on. So let's be fiery. Amen. Say fire of God.
Fire.
Baptize me from the crown of my head down to the sole of my feet. Hallelujah. Brother, sister, we need to learn the concept of building hedges around our life. When you build a hedge around your life, the enemy can't get to you. Job understood this concept. And whenever his children had parties, in the morning he would call all of them and sacrifice. And the Bible says when Satan tried to touch them, he couldn't. And he told God, you have put a hedge around him. I can't touch him. The Bible says in Zechariah 2 verse 5, for I, the Lord, will be a wall of fire around you and the glory in your midst. If the fire of God is around you, the enemy can't get to you. Amen. Hallelujah. And here in Isaiah 4, we begin to see a picture of that hedge that God has put around us. What is this fence? What is this protective hedge that God has put around us? In verse 5, can we read verse 5? Isaiah 4 verse 5. And the Lord will create upon every dwelling place of Mount Zion and upon her assemblies a cloud and smoke by day and the shining of a flaming fire by night. Upon all the glory shall be a defense. So the glory of God is like fire, right? It protects you. The Bible says every dwelling place of Mount Zion. Mount Zion is a type of the church. And the assemblies are the households within this church. So any house in this church, you are under a covering. One of my prayers when I'm praying for the church is, Father, every household in this church, I release the hedge of the cloud and smoke by day and the shining of a flaming fire by night upon every member, upon every follower of this ministry. Let your glory be a defense. You think the enemy can get to you? They can't get to you. You see how the police were fighting over you? Yeah, that was the glory. The glory confuses the enemy. The Bible says the enemy came against Gideon and they began to fight amongst themselves. Confusion is a weapon of God. So when the fire is there, your enemy are confused. They don't know what to do. The Bible says they came against Jehoshaphat, three armies. And one army rose up with another army and they exterminated the third army. And then when they finished exterminating that third army, then they began to fight among themselves. May the fire of God create confusion among the hosts of darkness that comes against you. In the mighty name of Jesus, the fire confuses the enemy. Hallelujah. The Lord will create upon every dwelling place. Say, Father, create upon my house the cloud and the smoke by day. Let the shining of the flaming fire be established on my house as a hedge and as my defense. Glory be to God in this house. I don't need a gun to defend myself. Hallelujah. I have something better than a gun. The glory of God is my defense. Hallelujah. There was a young man that was quite visionary. He came to our church once and then he saw in the realm of the spirit two angels, one by my side and one over here. And then he saw somebody like throwing arrows. And when the arrows come, the angels will just do something like this and it just extinguishes it. Amen. Now, if that is not protection, I don't know what is. I think that is better than guns. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. It is good to be under protection. Because this one is full of danger. The Bible says, I send you as sheep among wolves. We are among wolves. The Bible says we are in this world, but we are not of this world. And this world is full of dragons, according to Psalm 91. There are serpents, amen. There are lions. There are all these dangers around us. But the Bible says that he will cause his angels, who are fire, right? He will cause his angels to bear us up in their arms, so we don't strike our foot against a stone. The Bible says, no evil shall befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling or your house. See, my house is under God's protection. When you're sleeping at night, I want you to just picture this and say, Father, as I sleep tonight, let the glory cloud be a defense. May your glory cloud defend my children. Let your glory cloud be in my marital home, in my marriage room, in our master bedroom. Amen. No enemy can come there. Can the enemy come where the fire is? No. Hallelujah. Say, fire of God, fill my house with the glory of God. In the mighty name of Jesus. We need the fire of God in our life. Without the fire of God, we don't have direction. Without the fire of God, we don't have protection. But these things cause us to walk in this glory. Amen. One thing that the fire does is to fuel your weapons for war. Hallelujah. You see, we used to fight with bows and arrows, right? In the well, bows and arrows. Those were rather primitive. There's just so many people you can kill with bows and arrows. Until they realize that you can fuel your ammunition with fire. Somebody, I think something Bacon, whatever his name is, came out with this ammunition. And suddenly warfare changed. Syria, they are fighting with some rebels. And the rebels are complaining because they are expecting America to give them more, they call it firepower. They say, whatever you have been given to us is not powerful enough. And that is why Assad is beating us up. Give us some more firepower. And the White House is like, we don't know you. Whether one day you get the firepower, you turn the firepower on us. So we are confused. So we'll give you just a little bit to survive for now. You understand how this works? So firepower is everything in warfare. The more firepower you have, the easier you can win your battle. Amen. So if we have firepower in our warfare, we can do a lot of damage to the kingdom of darkness. I believe that is so. Can I hear a big amen?
Amen.
Okay, let's go to Isaiah 9. How do we wage our battles? With what material do we effect our warfare? Amen. Isaiah 9. Hallelujah. Verse 4, the Bible says, for thou hast broken the yoke of his burden. God wants to break the yoke of the burden upon your life. Every yoke in this house are commanded to be shattered in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus. And the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. Can we read verse 5? For every battle of the warrior, it's with confused noise, garments rolled in blood, and this shall be with what? Burning and full of fire. The Bible says that in a battle, we don't go and fight in suit and tie and shoes polished. No. It is gory. It is nasty. It's bloody. In fact, the Roman soldiers, they used to wear red. The reason why they wore red is so that when they are fighting and they are wounded and the blood is spilling out, nobody will realize it. So the guy will keep fighting even though he's losing blood. But if you can see the blood, it will mess you up, right? You get afraid, say, I'm dying. Well, there's still strength in you. All right? So fighting comes with, there's a lot of blood. Have you seen these war films? I love war films. Amen. I don't float that way. But if you give me a war film, I will sit there like this. Hallelujah. I like battle. I like killings. And the head flies up. Hallelujah. I like action film. That's me. Hallelujah. Boys, like you are too bloody. I don't care. I like it. Gladiator. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. I like that. Because I'm a warrior. Hallelujah. I like to fight. I like a battle. I'm like the horse in jokes. The horse knows the battle from afar and says, aha, let's get rolling. Amen. Because the only way you can win in this world is to fight. The Bible says that wage a good warfare with the prophecies that have been given to you. When a prophetic word is given to you, you must begin to do a work of seeing it come to pass by praying fire prayers. This is why we call certain prayers fire prayers. He says every battle. Everybody say every battle. He didn't say some fights. He says every fight you fight. It must be with confused noise. Is that in your Bible? Is that in your Bible? The Bible says that when the angel received the prayers of the saints, he poured fire on it. We'll get this soon. And it became hailstones. It became an earthquake. There was something in it. Gunpowder wasn't invented on the earth. It was invented in heaven. Man just caught onto it after some time. Thank goodness they didn't find that out too early, or all of us would have been. Amen. The Bible says that God has given us a shield of faith to quench the fiery darts. So the enemy uses fire against us. So you better answer fire with fire. Amen. I understand. I don't know how this works, so I may not be able to explain it well. But I hear that the fire service people, if they want to, keep a certain place from coming under fire, they'll put fire here. So when the fire comes, I don't know how it works out, but it kind of consumes each other and then it dies out. So the only way to battle fire is to put fire there. That doesn't seem right to me. I think you should put water there. No, they put fire there. Fire must answer fire.
Yes.
Amen. We must answer fire with
fire.
And our fire power is more, for there are more with us than there are against us. If God is for us, who can be against us? Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Every battle of the warrior is with confused noise. That's why we like noise in this house. Say, in Jesus' name. Every host of darkness that has risen up against me, receive the coals of fire in the name of Jesus. Burn! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's fire prayer. Amen. Every enemy that has come against me, I wipe you away in Jesus' name. That is not fire prayer. That is a game. That is rehearsal. It's like those little children playing daddy and mommy. They hold a wooden doll in their back. Hey, I'm mommy, you daddy. You're joking. If you mean business, Bible says that the kingdom of God has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. Hallelujah. The Bible says, with loud cries and tears, Jesus prayed. Amen. To the one who could hear him, and he was heard because of his obedience. We need fiery prayers. The kind of prayer that opened up the heavens is the kind of prayer that scribed heaven and wrote down so that we could read about it. Elijah prayed with fiery prayers. Hallelujah. Number one, confused noise. Garments rolled in. Brother and sister, number one, we are nothing without the blood of Jesus. We are completely useless without the blood of Jesus. If it wasn't for the blood of Jesus, we don't stand a chance in this world against the forces of darkness. They can wipe you out like that. But because of the blood of Jesus, they have no chance against us. Because when the blood is on your life, Jesus is on your life. God is on your life. The blood of Jesus upon your life is the seal of God upon your life, determining that you are a property of the Most High God, barring you from any demonic interference. When the seal of God is on your life, it authenticates what God is doing in your life. And it maintains the genuineness of your deliverance, the genuineness of your breakthrough. So when the blood was upon the door of the Egyptian houses, the death angel went to Korah's house. He says, Korah, I can take him out because he's a rebellious guy. But Korah had the blood upon his doorpost. He said, let me go to Abiram. Abiram had blood on his doorpost. Couldn't get to him. Every rebellious person in the camp of Israel, he went there. They couldn't get it. The Bible says, when the death angel sees the blood upon your doorpost, he will not be able to come there. When you are going to fight a battle, you must go with the blood of Jesus. You must soak yourself in the blood of the Lamb. Your garments must be rolled in blood. Hallelujah. Say, blood of Jesus, come into my spirit. Come into my soul. Come into my body. I drink the blood of Jesus. I cover myself from the crown of my head down to the sole of my feet with the blood of Jesus. I want us to shout blood of Jesus 7 times. Blood of Jesus. 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 One more time. Blood of Jesus. Glory be to God in this house. The enemy can't handle that. The death angel, one of the most powerful demons, could not enter those houses because of the blood of a goat. A blood of a goat kept an angel away. How much more the blood of Jesus? Hallelujah. The blood that was shed by the one who had never sinned before, the only begotten Son of God. That blood didn't come from Joseph. That blood didn't come from man. It is man that gives the blood. This blood came from the Most High God Himself. The Bible says that the power of high will overshadow you, and that which will be of thee will be a holy thing. So that blood is the blood of God Himself. So that blood, if the blood of a goat can handle it, how much more this blood? Say, blood of Jesus, touch me. Seal my life in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You must fall in love with the blood of Jesus. Amen. And then also, when you are fighting a war, the blood of the enemy will get on you too. Amen. How many of you have seen a war film like Gladiator? Yes, sir. After the bath, look at them, blood all over their body, they look dirty and nasty. But fighting is not pretty. Fighting is not nice. When the prayer warriors are praying and they are charged out, the hair weaves fly. The mascara flows down. The shirt is all in all different places. Shoes are no longer being used. Feet are stamping on the ground. Hands are waving in the air. I mean, spittle is going all over left and right. It's fiery. That's how a battle is. I get to listen. That's how you fight. Amen. Why do they shout when they are going to meet, when the armies face each other? When they are coming. Hallelujah. Why is that? They must charge themselves up. In my tribe, we say, Tobeli. Hey! That means we are charging ourselves up. Hallelujah. At times, even when people are running a race, I remember there was a guy who was a very good runner. Just that he was smoking too much. So by the time he gets to where he's on the 400 meters, by the 300, he's almost out. Then we begin to shout, Tobeli! Hey! Then we begin to say, the guy begins to shout. Something begins to move him. I'm telling you that noise moves. Noise moves. The shout of the king is in the camp. That is why the Bible says around the throne of God, there are noises, there are rumblings, and there are voices. Glory be to God. God likes noise. God likes noise. In one church I come from, they will tell us, quiet. They had a prayer book they gave to us. And there was a picture of somebody singing loud. And the person sitting by him was disturbed. And in the, underneath they said, don't make too much noise so that you will disturb the next person. I'm like, that thing came from the bottom of hell. Yes. If you are being disturbed, that means you yourself, you are not standing right. If you are disturbed by somebody's prayer, then you are not praying. Then you are spectating. May you be a man of fire. May you be a woman of fire. May your prayer altar receive the fire of God. When you pray, may heaven respond. May heaven move. Number one, you must fight with confused noise. That means that when you lift up your voice and you shout, it confuses the enemy. It confuses them. And number two, garments rolled in blood, the blood of Jesus. Amen. Number three, align the bat. You see the semicolon after the blood? It says, but this shall be with what? Burning and the fuel of fire. Do you read that? What fuels our meals? If one eats a meal, a nice meal, there's always fire underneath it. Amen? What fuels the bullets? When a gun is shot, don't you see fire coming out? What does the fire do? It pushes that bullet. So when you hear the gunshot, that means you have been hit already. Is that not so? So fire, when it pushes that bullet, is gone. Blessed be his holy name. And God is saying that when you fire the arrows of God, it is released with fire. When you release the coals of fire, fire bursts it. The Bible says, Moses told Pharaoh, tomorrow I will bring a nasty plague on this land. I will release hail. He didn't say anything about fire. He says, I will release hail. The next day when the hail came down, what happened? There was fire. It set the whole place on fire. The ammunition of God is fire. See, the ammunition of God is fire and brimstone. Hallelujah. Let's go to Psalm 11. Hallelujah. We are coming to a close. Amen. Blessed be his holy name. I like the fire of God. When God is releasing his weapons, fire is involved. But this shall be with fire, with burning and the fuel of fire. Shall fuel. I mean, what gets your car going? Fuel, right? So what fuels your battle? The fire of God. Amen. You must love fire from today. Amen. Verse 6. Are we all there? Upon Psalm 11, verse 6. Upon the wicked, he shall rain snares, fire and brimstone, and a horrible tempest. This shall be the portion of their cup. That means that when the Father is judging the wicked in your life, there's a cocktail of divine judgments that he releases. That cocktail includes snares or traps. That is why the Bible says the enemy will lay a snare or a trap of a net, and the net will catch themselves.
Amen.
They will dig a hole and they will fall into that hole themselves.
Amen.
They will shoot an arrow and the arrow comes back to them.
Amen.
That is what we call a snare. May the enemy receive the snares of God today.
Amen.
But those that come against your flesh to eat it up, may they receive the snares of God.
Amen.
The Bible says snares and what? Fire. And brimstone. This shall be, in fact, what caused even a horrible tempest. This shall be the portion of their cup. This shall be the portion of their cup. When Jesus says, I rebuke you, what comes behind the rebuke? We'll end with that. You know, every time we pray and then we say, the Lord rebuke you, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Isaiah 66, verse 15 and 16. Isaiah 66, 15 and 16. Again, we must understand that every battle is with burning and the fuel of fire. So when you are fighting, use the fire. Amen. The fire of God is what God has given to us. Why don't we use it? We must use the fire. Amen. Isaiah 66, verse 15. For behold, the Lord, that's Jehovah, will come with fire. And with his chariot like a whirlwind to render his anger with. So that means that there's anger, but there's fury. Anger is internal, fury is external. And fury is anger expressed or anger in manifestation. Amen. So when someone is angry, that's not too bad. But when the fury comes out, that is when we are in trouble. That is when a hand will hit something. That is when a glass will be shattered. Amen. That is fury. You know, some people, when they are angry, they just keep quiet. Amen. But some people, when they are angry, anything around them is broken up. They'll take their plate. Sow! Everything is scattered. That is what fury. So when God is angry, that's fine. But when his fury is released, fire comes. It says, I have seen Sodom and Gomorrah. I won't do anything now. Let me go and find out what is happening there. My angels keep telling me that Sodom and Gomorrah is doing something bad. But in the mouth of two or three witnesses, a matter is established. So I'm not going to take just their word. I'll come down and see this thing myself. And when he got there, they tried to sleep with him. Because they were in the well. What is this? Lord, you better get out now. If you don't get out quickly, you'll be consumed. Lot is wasting time. He takes him and throws him out of the city. And the Bible says, when Abraham woke up the next day, Sodom and Gomorrah were a pile of ashes. The rebuke of the Lord is crazy. 50 men went against Elijah to take him by force to the king of Israel. Elijah says, if I am a man of God, let the fire of God come down. Fire, see, the fire of God is more fiery than any fire you can experience from here. And the fire of God burns Elijah's altar and consumed the stones. I didn't know that bricks can be burnt by fire. It consumed them and consumed the water and it left a big hole in the ground. That is some fire. That is the fire of God. 50 men, ashes. And next 50 men came. That is the rebuke of the Lord. Brother, sister, we don't fight physical guys anymore. Amen. What we deal with is what? Spirits. The Bible says we don't fight with flesh and blood. Don't make your battles about people. There's something behind them. Deal with that, not the person. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says the Lord will come with fire. Amen. So when God is in fury, things get burnt up. To render his anger with fury, and his rebuke with what? Flames. So when Jesus says, I rebuke you, it means a lot. We only hear, I rebuke you, but if your eye could open in the spiritual realm, his fire goes out. Say, Satan, I rebuke you. In the name of Jesus. Every slumbering spirit stifling my prayer life, I rebuke you with the flames of fire. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That is fire prayer. May God release fire in our life today. Can we read verse 16? For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many. Glory be to God in this place. But brothers and sisters, to be able to release the fire, you must be fire. Amen. You can't release fire when there's no fire in you. You must be full of fire. What settled on the heads of the saints? Tongues of fire. The Bible could have said hands of fire or feet of fire. Amen. Or head of fire. It said tongues of fire. Have you ever seen fire? Fire is almost like a tongue. That means as you pray in the spirit, I say that the fire rested on them and the Holy Ghost filled them and they began to speak, hallelujah, with other tongues. As the Spirit gave them, the Holy Ghost allowed them to partake of the fiery nature of God by touching their lips and granting utterance to their spirit man to release that way. The Bible says that those that believe in me, in my name, they will speak with what? That's if you believe. Hallelujah. Say you will cast out devils, you heal the sick, but you will speak in tongues. Now you understand why the enemy has attacked speaking in tongues. Oh, this is why. You see why? Because that is how you tap into the nature of God. When you pray in the spirit, you are tapping into the very nature of who God is. And that substance rubs off on you. After 3 hours of praying in tongues, my brother, my sister, you walk on that water. Nothing can touch you. You will see things. When you pray in the spirit a lot, the fire of God will direct you. You will know things without anybody telling you. You will speak to things that will affect people. When you say jump, something will jump. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But if there's no fire, you say boom and nothing moves. May the fire of God be within you. May the Lord stir up everything in us that has died down. May every gift of God within us be stirred into flame. The gifts of God are pictured as fire. Amen. It is pictured as what? May the Lord fan into flame the gift of God that is within you. Without the fire of God, you are useless and nothing. Amen. That is why Jesus baptizes you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Say, Lord Jesus, baptize me with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Finally, the fire of God is where people who don't believe in God, that's where they go to. It's called hell. Amen. There's another side to this fire story. Amen. That is not your portion. Let me put it another way. That shouldn't be your portion. Make sure you don't go there. After staying in this hot place for a while, this is nothing compared to the fire there. I'm kind of feeling warm now. Amen. So, but this is nothing, nothing compared to hell. You see that rich man? He said what? Let this guy just dip the tip of his finger in water and put it on my tongue to cool my tongue. Abraham said, I wish I could do that, but there's a big gap between me and you. I can't come from it. If you want to come there, we can. And you two can't come here. I don't want this fire. Let's go to Mark 9. We're about to end. Amen. You know, when I say we're about to end the second time, that means we are really winding down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good. Hallelujah. Don't you love me? Yes. You love me?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Hallelujah. Mark 9, verse 43. You know, some people have made themselves happy. Let me put it that way. And some people are teaching from the seminaries that hell is a figmentation of our imagination. In the Bible, why do you want to gamble with your life like that? Why do you want to die to find out this? I have seen my God heal the sick. I have seen my God cast out devils. I have seen my God do some amazing things. And if he did all this, then what he says about hellfire must also be true. Amen. So whatever you cut yourself off, it will mess you up. Hell is real, and Jesus spoke about hell. Are we all in this house? We are ending. Verse 43. He said, "This." And who is the one speaking here? Jesus is the person speaking. He said, "And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. For it is better for thee to enter into life or heaven maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that cannot be. So hell fire can't be quenched. Amen. He says that if you have a problem in your life, deal with it whilst you are alive. Don't die with that problem. And if you have a problem with your hand, cut it off. That means that whatever your hand is touched that is not right, stop it. Yes. Amen. Yes. Say, my hand will touch you unclean thing. Some hands are touching some stuff. At times the hand is touching stuff like this. They balance a stick. Cut it off. Why do you want to enter into hell with both hands? If you cut off this hand, you go to heaven with one hand, and God will restore it. In heaven, there's healing. There's no sickness. There's no sorrow. So you can go lame and you come out. There's this man of God I love so much called Perry Stone. His father died the last few years. And he was very messed up. But he loved his father very much. And God gave this man of God a vision. He saw his father, hallelujah. His father was an old man with gray hair, beautiful gray hair. And he saw his father, you know, like passing into heaven. And he saw him as an old man, you know, crunched over. He had prostate cancer, he had all kinds of sicknesses, all crunched over. And then he passed a certain barrier, and then he straightened up. And then he became whole and strong and became a young man. He saw that God gave him this vision of what happened to his father. He saw angels coming and clothing him, giving him a new change of clothes. Don't you want this? Yes. I want this. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So you may go into life maimed, but God will heal you. Yes. But if you go with both hands into hell, in hell they can cut off your hands. You know that? We won't go into that today. Hallelujah. Let's continue. It says that into the hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched, and if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, where the fire that can never be quenched, where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. That means where you go, where you frequent, the hotels you go to, amen. The places you go to, you gotta be careful. Hotels are powerful places. I have learned that when I go to a hotel, I need to really sanctify the place. Because a lot of things happens at hotels. Oh yeah. It's a rendezvous. It's a place of intercession for a privacy. Hallelujah. Amen. You may have a nice home with a beautiful bed, but the hotel is more, you know, amenable to certain things. Some people meet their second wives and third wives in the hotels. The hotel is a powerful place. There's secrecy, hallelujah. Amen. If you will cut your leg off and stay with your wife and stay with your husband, the Bible says you'll go into life maimed, or God will heal you. But you go with everything intact, it's not gonna be good for you. It's not gonna be good. You need to make a decision that if my hand is messing me up, I'm gonna cast it off. If my leg is messing me up, I'm gonna put it off. We have to be careful where we go. At times our problems is not a demon, it's where we go. Can I say that again? At times it's not a demon, it's that you like to go there yourself. And don't come and have me cast a demon out of you when you are just like you, you just like it. Where there's a demon, will cast it out. But where it's your flesh, you got to deal with it. You got to crucify it. See, flesh, I crucify you. Fornication, I crucify you. Concupiscence, I crucify you. Lasciviousness, I crucify you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. That amen was very weak. I'll take it. Amen. Hallelujah. The last one, verse 47. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. For everyone shall be salted with fire, and every sacrifice shall be salted with
salt.
Hallelujah. I hear that in America, pornography has taken over more than 50% of the men. I think that is a conservative number. The person you are watching on that tube, do you know that person? Oh, I don't know that person. That is, that way I'm not sleeping with anybody for real. It's just something I'm watching. But do you know that person? Maybe that person has been forced into it. You know, people, you know, kidnapping young girls and all that stuff. You are watching somebody who has been kidnapped. You are now part of that practice as far as God is concerned. And the Bible says, if you look at a woman to lust after her in your heart, you have committed adultery. So adultery, as far as God is concerned, is not the actual act of sleeping physically with somebody only. Now that is bad, because if you sleep physically with a person, it will touch your body, physical, emotional, and spiritual plane. But just watching it goes into your heart, your innermost being, and tarnishes and blemishes your heart. And now you give the devil a legal ground in your life to mess you up. Say in Jesus' name, I put to death lust of the eyes. In the name of Jesus, I put to death lust of the eyes. In the name of Jesus. At times you have to throw that computer away. I'll say it again. At times you have to do something symbolic to cut off with that thing. At times you have to throw that whole computer away. It is a symbolic act. Those books, go and pick it up. Throw it away. Those magazines, you can wait when everybody goes out of the house. You say, Father, it's me and you. Then you go to the basement. You look here and there and take it and burn it. When your wife comes, oh, wait, no, I'm just wanted to burn some papers that I don't need anymore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God will help you. Say, God will help me. Brother, sister, when you do these things, you allow God to have more room to help you. This physical act helps God to help you. Amen. If you are repenting, you must stop before you can ask God for help. Some people, they want to make sure that God is helping them before they help themselves. That doesn't work that way. Repent and God will help you. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for what your fire is doing in our life. Your fire comes to enable us to do ministry. Your fire empowers us for your service. Your fire also is used in our warfare. Your fire protects us. Your fire watches over our life. Because of your fire, the enemy is kept at bay. But there is also hellfire. That is for those who cannot control themselves. Father, we thank you that you have saved us by the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, those things within us that are threatening to cripple our eternal destination, Father, we ask for your fire. I'm not going to ask anybody to stand up. I just want you to pray and mean it in your heart. Say, Father, release your fire into my life. Those lustful urges, those lustful desires, the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh, those secret sins that plague my life, Lord Jesus, save me in the name of Jesus. Your word says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Save me. Subdue my iniquities by the blood of Jesus. I renounce lust. I lose myself from it. Any spirit of lust in my life, I come against you now. I command you to leave me now. Go with every breath. In the name of Jesus, every spirit of fornication, get out of my life now. In the name of Jesus, go with every breath. In the name of the Lord Jesus, every foul spirit of pornography, I overcome you by the blood of Jesus. I eject you. I cast you out. I expel you from my life now in the name of Jesus. Father, cleanse my mind, cleanse my heart, cleanse my body from every filth, from every defilement by the blood of Jesus. Blood of Jesus, cleanse my conscience in the name of the Lord Jesus. I thank you, Father. Holy Ghost fire, consume every sediment of the devil in my life in Jesus' name. Then ladies, just hold your womb. Ladies, hold your womb. Say, every demonic seed in my womb, receive the fire of God in the name of Jesus. Every demonic seed in my womb, catch fire in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Stand on your feet right now and put both hands on your head and say, Holy Ghost fire, baptize me from the crown of my head down to the sole of my feet. Holy Ghost fire, baptize me from the crown of my head down to the sole of my feet in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. God is doing something right now. God is setting people free. In this prayer, God has set many people free. Many have been set free. You find that that edge is gone. That desire is gone. All you have to do from now is just use self-control. You don't need to go to that place anymore. God is helping you. May the grace of God enable you right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for your people. They have heard your word. I thank you that you are the consuming fire. You are the one that can do this work on our behalf. Father, may your fire burn through us from the crown of our head down to the sole of our feet. In the name of Jesus, I step into my office as an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven. And I command every spirit of lust right now, get out. Leave right now. With every breath, go. By the blood of Jesus, leave. I move every foul and clean spirit out of this house. Go with every breath. Leave right now in the name of Jesus. You are no longer valid here. Go with every breath. Leave right now. I exercise my authority as the Son of the living God. And in the name of Jesus, I command every foul spirit of fornication, leave. Go with every breath. In the mighty name of Jesus, I release the fire of God in this house. I command prayer altars in this house to receive the fire of God. Every dormant gift, I ignite you with the fire of God. I command every gift that is now burnt out to receive a refreshing by the blood of Jesus. I release that fire. I release that fire in this house. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah.